Good morning, Vivek. I can see you there.
Wait a second, I'll come to. Yeah, good morning, sir.
Yes, good morning.
Can you all hear me?
Yes, we can hear you very clearly, and we can see Hello? You also on the white screen here.
Okay. Okay, that's great. So I will start with the history of this patient. He is a 62-year-old gentleman with a history of diabetes and hypertension. He has symptoms of chronic limb ischemia in the form of he has a non-healing ulcer on the left foot, and also he had ulcers on the right foot for which the amputation of the four toes has been done.
Okay.
I will show you the diagnostic angiogram. We are lucky that his other vessels are good, but he has got a short segment stenosis in the right posterior tibial and a narrowing distal to it.
Okay.
So the plan is to do an angioplasty for the distal posterior tibial.
Okay.
And there is a small segment narrowing for which we will be putting a biodegradable scaffold. Yeah.
Okay.
So I'll just show you the runs now. Can you see the runs from there?
No, we're just seeing you just now. Yeah, there the run comes in, yeah.
Okay, sir, can you see the screen now? Yeah.
Yes, yes.
So this is a superficial femoral, the right side, which looks good. There are some areas, a few areas of calcification, the flow is good. The next run, please. So this is the popliteal and the trifurcation.
Very nice, yeah.
Yeah. The next one, please. This is a selective run of the PT trunk, which
yes.
shows the posterior tibial and the peroneal.
Yes.
You can appreciate that small segment significant stenosis.
Yes.
When the other vessels are good, I think by treating this small segment vessel may help the patient.
Yes.
Just show the anterior tibial run, please.
So Vivek, you have taken selective catheter and made injections. You're showing some brilliant pictures.
Yeah, so this is the anterior tibial.
Yes. Yeah.
Which is seen very well till the ankle in the next run. We have gone from the opposite side with a 6-French crossover sheath.
Okay.
And crossed the lesion with a 14 command wire.
Okay.
So now we are all set for the plasty. I will be using 2mm balloon.
Okay.
2mm 250.
So here in this 200. Case, Vivek.
2x200.
Vivek,
yeah.
The foot, as you see that anterior tibial
yes,
artery, the dorsalis pedis is occluded. So your
yeah.
chance of saving
yeah.
the foot is only if you open up the posterior tibial artery.
Right, sir.
Okay. So in peripheral,
yeah.
this is
so
one
we are loading
thing
the balloon
that you
now.
Have to realize it.
Yeah.
Where's the ulcer? You said on the right foot. Where is it located?
He has ulcers on the both the foot.
Okay.
On the left side, it is on the plantar aspect. On the right side, he has gangrene of the he had gangrene of the toes for
okay.
which the four toes has been amputated.
Okay, okay. So this is a densely calcified tibial arteries.
Yeah.
So I can see the wire in one of the plantar branches.
Yes, sir.
Getting the balloon up.
So maybe we can stage the procedure. First we treat the distal posterior tibial artery, and after that we will see if needed we can go for the plantar arch revascularization.
What is the size of the
step.
Balloon? What have you taken there?
This is 2x200.
2x200, okay.
The plan is so that I can treat the I can treat the small segment also, we can plasty the same go.
Okay.
The idea for selecting the longer balloon was, I did not want the plaque to get, it is a small size vessel with a calcification. So if a one go, if I can plasty the longer segment, that will be better rather than repeating multiple plasties.
Okay. Okay. But then, do you realize once
in a while... Inflating the balloon now. Yeah.
Tracking it down could be difficult if there is a long
balloon.
Yes, sir. Sometimes this went down very easily.
Yes,
sir.
But in this case,
yeah.
Right. Yes. Sir, since the vessels were pretty opacified pretty well, I took this decision of selecting a longer balloon.
Okay.
If this would have been a little more diffuse disease, I would have gone for a smaller one.
Okay.
Okay. Inflating.
Fair enough.
We are inflating the balloon now.
I'm at 2, 3, 3.
Yeah, we can see that narrowed segment.
Yeah.
How many atmospheres you will inflate?
5.
Vivek, what
our
atmosphere?
Plan is to go till 6 atmosphere only, which is a nominal. We are at 4 atmosphere right now. I am planning to go max till 6.
6?
Yeah.
The question is why not more?
Why not more?
Yeah. Sir, if you go more than that, we might rupture the plaque. It's a small size vessel, I don't want to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Because that a small plaque can also further cause a problem in the distal flow.
Your distal segment has still not opened.
Idea
up,
is to just open a vessel and give adequate flow for ulcer to heal.
Mm-hmm.
And I was expecting that after this plasty, the vessel will become so clear that I may not see that small stenosis, segmental stenosis. So if you can see on the screen, we have already put a marker, so we know where exactly we want to put the scaffold.
You know, Vivek, there is a question here that we are still seeing a narrowing on the balloon still there. There is a waist there at two levels. Yeah, that's the one, and one which is lower down. So I wouldn't mind inflating a little higher also and holding the balloon for a little longer time. Maybe at least 3 minute dilatation at a higher pressure.
Yeah. Yeah,
I go
3 minutes.
To 14 and 16 also. Yeah.
Even 18, even 20 sometimes.
Yeah. So it is gone
now. Your waist is gone.
We are at 8.
Go up to 10, 12.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just see if you can get a little more. Don't worry.
There is also
Yeah. Okay.
Now the waist is gone.
Yeah. So we are at 10 now.
Yes. How often have you seen rupture? I mean, you're doing peripheral, you know. Do you see ruptures or with the balloon? Never.
Sir, what not the vessel rupture. I'm worried. No, sir. I never
just
seen. It's only the plaque which gets little dissection or small dissection and then we prolong the procedure and further more steps.
Okay. Okay. So your worry is the dissection that can happen. Fair enough. Yes.
Yeah, and in a small vessel, a small plaque which is causing the distal, blocking the distal flow again.
Right.
So my idea was to just give enough flow for the foot to heal.
Right. Okay, so now you keep this balloon inflated for how long normally?
So 3 minutes.
Three minutes. Okay. And do you use these drug-coated balloons in the tibials?
Yes, sir, we have used.
Right.
But in this case, we are not planning to use one. This is a plain balloon.
Okay.
Because we are planning to put a scaffold.
Okay.
Which is a sirolimus coated.
Right. Okay. So that you're trying to put it in the mid-calf region, the upper lesion.
Right.
Okay.
She started.
So in peripheral, this is the waiting time that you have to give for all the patients. I mean, this is prolonged dilatation. You have to have patience to hold yourself and just keep on waiting for that period. If you are a little more anxious person like me, you should get out of the cath lab.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, you try to do things very fast.
Yeah. It's done? 3 minutes? Yeah. So we are deflating the balloon now.
Yeah. I think he's planning to put a stent there probably. The scaffold probably. I would have gone up. Yes.
Done?
These calcified arteries is what we normally see in our diabetic patients and in general with diabetes and smoking together, the disease is quite extensive. So this wire is which one? You've used a filter or what have you used here? Command wire.
No, sir, this is a command wire.
Command wire.
14th
okay.
Command wire.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you're always using command wire for recognition, or not?
Vivek?
I always.
Do you always use command wire?
I use either command or nitrex.
Below
me, I use either command or nitrex, sir.
Okay. So often, it's very important, I keep on telling my colleagues that your number of wires and catheters and the technology should be limited. There are so many things available in the market. You get used to one or two of them and just use them. And that will help you in the long run. So here he is used to command wire and nitrex. If there is a CTO, nitrex is a good wire, something like a weighted wire. So some people use that, and if you're used to it, fair enough. My choice often is, if there is a stenotic lesion, then I use a filter FC 300 centimeter.
Balloon is
or
stuck.
If it is a CTO, then I often use Conquest Pro or any of these weighted wires from Cook that I often use.
And for me, always I use always common wire because it's tip very, very stable and it is not it's difficult to shape, but it's anyway, it's difficult to break the tip.
That.
Yes.
Okay.
Hold the wire.
The wire is coming back here. Yeah? So
you can cut balloon
on the wire.
You can cut balloon if you losing wire or not. Hmm. I'm doing something.
Yeah.
Like
yeah. I think I should do that.
Yeah, so this is another problem because the length, this is over the wire balloons, often it becomes difficult to take out the whole balloon when you are kind of taking it out. And the wire tends to come out during the whole process. So two things that I do definitely with these patients is flush the catheter, the balloon catheter, the wires, wire lumen very nicely. And any time that you are exchanging, always have good saline to wipe the wire. That helps to take this catheter out very easily. The hydrophilic coating inside the catheter is what becomes sticky and pulls out the wire.
But sometimes it's difficult to cut 014 wire.
I think I might lose the wire.
Okay, yes.
To push the wire with
yes.
The line.
Okay, I got the wire.
Got the wire?
Yeah.
So hold the wire tight. Hold the wire tight.
I'm holding the wire.
Yeah, so you always require two people to do this procedure.
You're holding the wire?
Yes.
One person holding the wire there, somebody
hold
is
it tightly.
Pulling out the catheter.
Hold it tightly, no chance.
Yes. And losing the wire is a big challenge because you've already plastered that segment. Yes.
My second worry is maybe the spasm because of this wire thing.
Yes.
Is contrast?
No, sir. I'll take it.
Yes. I think a very practical question here is why did you use the contralateral approach, number one? And number two is. Yeah.
This patient has already undergone angiography from the right side, and we had used a closure device that time. So with the closure device, it is recommended that we should not puncture the same side again for at least the next 3 weeks. And that
okay.
is the reason we have gone contralateral in this case.
Okay, okay.
And which kind of closure device you used? AngioSeal?
Which closure device did you use?
We have used Obtura.
Okay.
I think I have to let the Nimodipine run for some time.
Sorry? Closure device?
Give me a good Obturita contrast,
like
a non-diluted one.
Obturita is our, it's Merrill product. We'll show you that during the presentation there. It's a very simple, very effective closure device.
So the guiding, the wire wiring is going to.
Yes, Vivek. So now your contrast
just
injection
confirming the
is
run.
From, yeah.
I will put the. Yeah, from the sheath, which is from the common femoral, so maybe we'll not get a very good run.
Yes. This is fairly good.
Yeah. The plan is to put a scaffold there and let nimodipine run for some time.
Okay. So that's a short segment narrowing that we are seeing up there,
sure,
in the mid tibial artery.
Yeah.
Posterior tibial artery, yes.
Right. 2.75 is enough. 2.75 and 19.
So you are taking a.
We are putting 2.75 by 19 mm scaffold.
Yes. So this is a balloon mounted scaffold, bioresorbable scaffold from Merrill. And
yeah,
we call it the Credence BTK.
Mid-course.
These are. You know, very focused short segment stenosis, so he could place it over there. And we've now done more than 25 cases with this scaffold. And I'm personally involved in about six or seven of them. Six, I think, we've done. And I've got very good results with this scaffold now, so far.
Load
this is
this.
Sirolimus coated polylactic acid. Polymer that is used in this patient.
Okay.
The biggest size is 3.5, Sanjay. The 3.5 is the biggest size that we have it for the BTK. We also have it for the iliac,
below
going up to 10.
The biggest size is 3.5.
And we have it for the renals also now. The renal is called the melange, and the iliac is called the BRS. Bioresorbable scaffold for Credence BRS, we call it.
Sure. The biggest for the TBL is 4 mm, 440.
440 we have it, yeah?
Yeah, yeah. Loading?
How many of you use IVUS for the peripheral? Do you use IVUS for the peripheral? No. Okay. No, we don't use it. What's happening now?
You are loading the scaffold.
Just take care of your hand. Whose hand is that? No, it's not
just
patient's hand.
From the Ashan, you need not hit it. You need not hold it.
Whose hand is that?
Just remove. It's the assistant's hand.
Yes, be careful.
It was Ashan's hand. He was very much worried that he should not lose the wire.
Okay, okay.
Since
okay.
This is the RX system, I don't need that.
So there you have the scaffold coming down.
Yeah.
Yeah. So do you use the roadmap for that? Or?
Sir, we have marked it on the screen.
Okay. Okay.
With a marker.
Okay.
Because I was expecting that after initial plasty, I may not see that particular lesion.
Very good. Excellent. So,
so
there are various ways of
the particular segment, I have marked it on the screen.
Okay.
Yeah. So we are inflating.
So this is 2.75 into 19, right?
19, yeah.
Yeah.
Inflating.
Before atmosphere.
Okay.
Gradually.
Gradually.
One, and then
two.
One.
You would say.
Then two, and then two.
So you
three.
Slowly inflate the balloon, right? In this.
Four. Yeah. Right. So we are at four now. We are waiting for four. Seconds.
10 seconds.
Go to 5.
Okay.
Again, wait. This has to be done very gradually.
Yes.
We are counting 10 seconds after each atmosphere.
Okay.
And
we are at 7 now.
For a scaffold? To inflate such way.
Yeah. So is it very special to do this for the scaffold, Vivek?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So every time you inflate a little and hold it for 10 seconds and then inflate again.
Yeah. Initial, yes, sir. Initial 4 atmosphere we go. And
yes.
Then after each atmosphere, we wait for 10 seconds and then inflate it. How much have we reached?
This is
we are at 9.
Yeah.
I guess. Which is a nominal, and we'll wait for 1 minute.
Okay.
There is a little waste scene for which I'll be doing a postplasty again with a higher pressure. Now this particular inflation, and we are waiting for the drug to act there.
Okay. So it's very important to prepare the bed. You have to pre-dilate it.
Yeah.
We have to pre-dilate it, prepare the bed, and then get the scaffold and inflate it over there.
We are waiting for 1 minute now.
Yes.
With the same balloon, we can go up, right?
Sanket, you have a mic with you?
And then we'll go up.
He does not have, right?
Sanket, do you have a mic with you?
Sanket represents Merrill in the peripheral portfolio.
Okay. Yeah.
Now we'll go higher pressure.
Yeah. Same with this.
But then I think when you do predilatation, you must for higher pressures, because you then there is no such residual stenosis, or even take the little bigger balloon for predilatation, because it will be the better preparation.
Right.
Okay. Inflating.
Inflate.
Sanket, inflating.
Vimal.
Yeah.
I have a question for you.
Yeah. Now you can go regular.
From the expert panel, this bioresorbable 14. Scaffold, the characteristics are the same like Maris 100, or is something different?
No, I think the characteristics are more or less similar, especially for the BTK lesions. So the characteristics are more or less the same. The strut diameters are the same.
12.
The drug volume is also the same. The drug is also sirolimus. So everything is more or less the same. Have you changed anything for the BTK here?
Yeah, we are at 14.
So we have the same characteristic of Meres 100 for credence BTK. The strut thickness remains 100 microns.
Yeah.
And we have the drug loading of 1.25 micrograms per millimeter square.
Right.
The largest diameter is 4, and the longest length is up to 40 millimeter. The starting length is 8 millimeter.
So there it is. It's more or less the MRIS that we have for the coronary. So now this is at a higher pressure that you've got the balloon now.
Yeah, we are at a 14 atmosphere.
And again, you will hold it for a while?
Yeah.
Okay.
How much time? How much time we have done? Yeah. Chal. We are deflating.
Yes.
Put a negative thing on and we pull it. Okay?
I have a question.
Wait, just look. Yeah.
I can't disconnect it. Can you disconnect it?
So it goes through a 4-French introducer very conveniently without any problem. But since this is a crossover sheath, I'm sure he has used a 6 French sheath just now.
Yeah, 6 French. Yes,
yeah.
Sir.
So usually my approach in this peripheral, if I'm doing crossover, is if I'm doing SFA or iliac where I need to put big stents, then I take a 7 French crossover. Though most of the companies recommend 6 French, I take 7 because it becomes very easy to introduce it and make contrast injections if you want to. If I'm doing the tibials, then I take 6 French. We do not have these long crossover sheets which can go all the way down up to the popliteal from Cook. If we get that, then one can use a 4 French also and work with the 4 French sheath also.
Run, please.
This is final proof of the pudding.
I think we need to go a little down and take a better run.
Yes.
For demonstration.
Yes, I think maybe you may need to just go down into the below the ankle to open that segment. Would you recommend that?
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Sir, I'll let the nimodipine run for some time and then I'll put in a balloon again.
Okay.
We already have a scaffold now there.
Yes. Okay.
I think only at the ankle there is little diffuse areas.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure once the wire is out, you'll get a little better lumen and better flow there. And probably you will demonstrate it much better once you have a catheter in the popliteal artery and make an injection. It often becomes too much of dilution all the way down when it comes down.
4 French catheter, yeah. Give me a 4 French catheter.
So how often do you use any of these vasodilators like NTG or Nimodip or something like that?
Sir, when we are doing below knee.
Yes.
When we are doing below knee cases, we always have a nimodipine flush which is going on from the sheath.
Okay.
I generally keep it for the below knee.
And how much of heparin have you used so far?
We have given 5,000 units of heparin.
Okay. 5,000 units. Yeah. Most of us use the same. And then antiplatelets are already
and
on, right?
And then if the procedure is going on? Yeah, patient is already on antiplatelet. If the procedure gets prolonged, we repeat 1,000 units of heparin every hourly.
Okay.
And you give antiplatelets before or after procedure?
Patient is already on antiplatelets.
But usually?
So normally we, if the patient is already on, fair enough, we want a dual antiplatelets on these patients. And at least 3 days prior to the procedure is what I would normally give them. And often these are not an emergency situation where you need to load them or anything. But if I have to load them, then I just give 600 aspirin and 300 clopidogrel.
Yeah, I'm taking the wire out.
He's got a catheter there.
Yeah, I'm taking a wire out now.
Yes.
And taking a run to demonstrate.
You know, if you wanted the wire to be inside, you could have used a Y connector.
Yeah, the Y way, the Y connector, right.
Yeah.
Center, please.
How is the creatinine of this patient?
Yeah.
It's very important in all these diabetic foot patients to evaluate the creatinine levels.
Three-way, please.
This is a typical extensive atherosclerotic disease, calcified plaque along the full length of the
you saw that run?
Arteries. Yeah.
Run, Karna. Just hold on.
Sorry?
Are they using poor contrast or diluted contrast?
So this is the final run.
Yes.
This is a diluted contrast. But since our catheter is right there, maybe we got this run.
So we always use half strength.
In fact, the injection contrast was so good.
Okay, and what do we see down
I
there?
I did not get the question. Was there any question for me?
Yeah, that was full strength contrast or half strength contrast, which you answered there, yeah.
No, this was a half strength contrast. This was a diluted contrast. Yeah. Give me one more.
Lower down.
Focus lower down. Center. I think the area we have plastered,
yes,
is opened well.
Yeah, that segment has opened well. Distally, we need to kind of find out what to do.
Yeah.
Because the plantar branches.
Plan is to wait at this stage.
Okay.
Yeah. And then maybe we will see him after again whether we want to reconstruct the plantar arch in a second setting.
Okay. Though there are plantar branches are filling up, and I'm sure with the improved pressure head, there would be improvement in the flow in these branches also. There you can see the plantar branches filling up there, with the calcaneal branches all filling up that segment.
And where is the ulcers in the foot? Where are the ulcers?
Where are the ulcers?
Where? In which part of the foot?
He has amputated, he has undergone amputation for the lateral four digits. The second to fifth digits are amputated.
Okay.
You can focus there on the leg. Foot.
Just take the separate view for the foot only completely, Vivek. You can take the patient up a little bit.
Yeah, okay.
Just take a good photo of the foot so we will know the vascularity there.
Yeah. Foot, show the foot.
5 cc, 10 cc.
5 cc.
We have to realize it that our target organ or the target tissue is the foot. So we should have a good imaging of the foot before and after the plasty.
Yeah.
That gives us a complete answer then. And you can decide whether this patient will do well or not.
Chacha, pair modo thoda. थोड़ा बीच में ऐसे ऐसे सेंटर प्लीज सेंटर मोर सेंटर सेंटर सेंटर
इफ यू सी द स्क्रीन साइज द फ्लैट पैनल साइज इज रियली बिग विद पेरिफेरल वी हैव 14 इंच फ्लैट पैनल एज अगेंस्ट 9 इंच व्हिच वी यूज फॉर कॉरोनरी सो दैट इन वन इमेज यू कैन You can again extend it.
Need to pull the patient.
Sort of do that. Enough. Just check. Yeah. That's okay.
Yeah, just make it lateral completely or then make the screen oblique if you want.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's perfect.
Okay?
Yes.
No.
Yeah, probably you'll have to do the lower end. I think it looks like.
Yeah, the plantar.
You'll have to probably touch the lower end to get the posterior tibial flow to improve. Another thing that I look at is how is the flow in the other two arteries? How fast they are going down? So finally, the artery that you've angioplastied, the flow should be rapid and faster or equal to. Then you know that you've done well.
Dr. Vimal, what do you think about Dr. Vimal?
Yeah, I can hear you.
What do you think about approaching plantar right away in this session?
I think so, you should. I know there is a scaffold sitting there, but if you take a smaller balloon through the scaffold, NY balloon, then it will slip through the stent and you can go down, keep little heparin dose, and then try and go down and open up the plantar branch. That will finally give the good flow to that foot area. I know that's a lot of work still.
Yeah.
Okay. So, any more questions to him? Yeah?
I personally couldn't understand. This gentleman has generally three arteries below the knee with one stenosis on the artery and four fingers lost. A little bit seems to me strange that the reason is these three arteries. I think the situation is for the diabetes and probably he needs some prostavazina and the drugs of that type. I mean, seems strange. Three arteries, open arteries. Yes, stenotic, but open arteries. Perfect femoral, perfect popliteal artery, and four fingers lost. I don't know. It seems a little bit strange.
Yes. So you
are absolutely right. Even when we saw the angiogram, we were also of the same opinion that he has the other two arteries which are patent. But the way he has undergone the tissue loss and amputation, we thought this is a small segment. We should give him a chance by opening up.
Okay. Yeah, so finally the,
another question. It's about diabetes mellitus, about you measure the HbA1c to know what the severe of this patient, saturation
what
of
is
blood
HbA1c?
On the his foot, and it's interesting to see the blood filling on anterior tibial artery, if it's possible in this session.
So you want to see the anterior tibial artery flow better?
Yeah, because posterior, there are occlusion below.
Just show it again.
No, I think we'll take a better run.
Yeah, if it's possible, because it seems like three arteries working. I think its saturation is good. That's why I think it's not important to increase the blood flow. Its saturation is good in this patient.
So here is the anterior tibial artery, as you're interested.
Yeah, yeah.
As you can see that the at the ankle joint, they're just collaterals. So the dorsalis pedis is not good.
Yeah.
Not good, yeah.
So that's the reason, you know, when you asked a question with, you know, three vessels, they are only good up to the ankle joint. The posterior tibial was occluded at the ankle and then not going much ahead. So we needed to open up that segment to see if we can improve the collateral flow to the toe areas. So even if the three vessels look good in the leg up to the ankle, but if the foot, the main dorsalis pedis or the plantar branches, the medial and the lateral plantar branches of the posterior tibial are occluded, again you will not have a good flow. And my approach in this patient would be that I would like to open up as much as possible, even if the patient goes for 4 foot amputation, at least that should heal. If the patient can walk on his heel, then that is good. Even if the toes are gone, if the calcaneum is preserved, we are still okay in these patients.
That's why it's interesting to see the anterior tibial artery because we don't see below the ankle.
Yes. So the dorsalis pedis artery out there is occluded and it's calcified. So that's the reason he didn't attempt to go into the anterior tibial artery. And you can just see the collaterals there. Can we run that show, run that picture again, the foot picture?
Yeah, please run this picture again. Sir, while deciding the approach, he had the anterior tibial artery, which is a little better than the posterior tibial artery.
These are just the collaterals.
Right.
Sorry, Vivek?
And the, sir, anterior tibial artery up to the ankle was better as compared to the posterior tibial artery.
Yes.
So we decided to treat the posterior tibial artery so that we at least increase the pulse pressure down.
Yes.
And give a chance for the collaterals to form.
I think even if this patient undergoes a 4-foot amputation, it should help him. It should help him in this.
Right.
May not
yeah.
be the
as long as the patient remains ambulatory, it should help.
Yeah.
Right.
And the last question, how many years it's need to absorb to disappear from vessel, this calcified vessel?
Yes. Okay, so probably I'll answer that, Vivek. How long does it take for this to absorb?
Yes, sir.
So normally we see about by 6 months we start seeing the resorption taking place, and within a year majority of the stent is resorbed, and in 2 years time we anticipate that the thing will get absorbed. In the peripheral we have not completed 2 years yet. We've just finished maybe 4 or 5 patients who have gone past 1 year now, and at present we don't see the stent. We are not doing IVUS for these patients, which would be the ideal way to assess the resorption, but we are doing Dopplers in these patients and trying to locate these stents. And I've seen that patients on whom 1 year is over, majority of the stent is resorbed by now. So I expect by 2 years, maybe few strands are left behind, that should be fine in these patients, and majority is absorbed. I don't know, in the coronary, what is the status now?
So as you rightly mentioned, by 6 months, the crystallinity of the scaffold is going away.
Yes.
And it starts degrading. By 1 year, practically you only see the markers and few struts. And 2 years in coronary is what we have seen. In 2 years follow-up with OCT, majority of the scaffold has been absorbed.
Okay. So Vivek, I think we will give you a chance to decide what further you want to do with this patient. But I think you did demonstrate very well how the tibial arteries are to be handled. It's definitely a different challenge compared to the SFA and the iliacs that we commonly do in these patients. And multivessel long segment calcified lesions are always a challenge to handle. Thank you very much, Vivek, and the team there for a great demonstration.
Thank you, sir.
And we really loved it and learned something from what you did today. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.